In his examination of the politics of representation of the Orient and Islam, Edward Said, as many of you must know, demonstrated the link between the forms of cultural knowledge produced about the Orient and the workings of colonial power relations, identifying Orientalism as a discourse that homogenized widely divergent peoples and societies. He argued that the process of knowing them became inseparable from the process of colonizing and controlling them. Said found this discourse to be rife in his latest study of US media reporting of Islam in the last decades of the 20th century. He said, in many instances, Islam has licensed not only patent inaccuracy, but also expressions of unrestrained ethnocentrism, cultural, and even racial hatred, deep yet paradoxically free-floating hostility. This is Said's analysis of how Islam gets covered in North American media. As a consequence of the grossly simplistic and overgeneralized reporting, as well as of misrepresentations and omissions, Said concluded, quote, that a great deal of covering up of Islam was taking place in the media. Do we see the same kind of covering up inaccuracies and what Said calls racial hatred towards Islam in the alternate media? Do we see the same kind of hostility towards the perspectives and political positions of believing Muslims? My answer would be mostly yes, with very few exceptions. The war on terror has revealed how deeply embedded is the racial logic within the state, national narratives, and also in social justice movements in the West, including the women's movement. Throughout the 1990s, in the women's movement in this country, we struggled very hard and very actively against the restructuring of the welfare state, against privatization and deregulation, as had other social justice movements in Canada, and NAC was at the forefront of that fight, many of you will remember. We had worked hard to review the links between the right-wing anti-woman agenda and the right-wing anti-immigrant agenda. We had highlighted how immigrant women were at the intersection of these damaging politics. We linked the anti-immigrant politics as the basis on which we saw the rise of the Reform Party, for one example, which has since moved into the mainstream and given Canada the Harper government. There was a public space where our anti-racist feminist politics could be articulated, even in the corporate media, to a very limited extent, but that space was there. Of course, the corporate media has never been friendly to such radical politics, and I'm not suggesting that it was, but the strength of our movements had managed to shake up some of the discourses around Canadian nationhood, around racial politics, around anti-immigrant politics, and how foundational they were to the whole project of globalization and the dismantling of the welfare state. The aftermath of 9/11, however, showed how fleeting that moment had been, how precarious the space had been that had been created by anti-racist movements, including anti-racist feminist movements in this country. And more disappointingly, it revealed how little we had actually managed to transform the politics of the women's movement and other mainstream social justice movements in this country. The intense Islamophobia that erupted in the mainstream media right after the 9/11 attacks was incredibly difficult to experience, especially the role that women activists play in fueling this Islamophobia by giving it a gendered legitimacy. As the Muslim community came under siege, left activists and feminist activists likewise turned against the politics of resistance that were being espoused by believing Muslims around the world, here in Canada as well, branding them either medieval fanatics or dupes. The left and feminists were no less enthusiastic than the neoliberals to save, quote unquote, the oppressed Muslim woman, which emerged as a central plank of the neoconservative pro-war ideology emanating from the Bush administration and adopted wholesale at that time by the Christian government. The defining of Muslim men as pre modern, as fundamentalists, as fanatics and supporters of terrorism, unless they articulated their politics in Western, liberal, colonial terms, became pervasive in this media. Even in the alternate media, the resuscitation of all discredited colonial constructs of Muslim women and the veil and of Muslim communities as inherently and always misogynist and patriarchal continued to abound. The sudden concern for the human rights of the Muslim woman have been identified as part of the new imperialism that is articulated in the Orientalist tropes of barbaric Muslim communities and societies and enlightened Western communities and Western societies. The war on terror, therefore, is a profound lesson about how fragile the changes had been that we had sought to make in anti-racist, anti-imperialist, and feminist movements here in Canada. The war revealed how quickly the gains of those movements could be pushed back and how quickly the feminist and other social justice movements could ally themselves with the state and with national security interests in global politics. The war on terror, I would argue, has become a watershed moment. It has been used by states around the world, including in Canada as well, to restructure their societies, to push forward draconian forms of surveillance, militarization, and the remaking of the repressive apparatus of the state. This is accompanied by intense anti-immigrant sentiments, erosion of their rights, and escalation of violence and discrimination in everyday life. We can feel it in our workplaces, in the classes we teach, in the practices of the state, in the culture that we consume. Claims of Western superiority have become greatly strengthened. They have become much more brazen, as have notions of third world barbarism, centered now on Islam and Muslims. The intense Islamophobia, which has now become deeply institutionalized in the state and more deeply embedded in public culture and politics, has damaged, I would argue, very deeply the possibilities for alliance among revolutionary movements in a profound manner. The response to the imperialism of state policies and practices by nationals, activists in the women's movement and social justice movement, this is what has changed the political landscape, the legitimacy and the credibility that many feminists have given this Islamophobic discourse, which has made it as powerful as it has become. So what does this Islamophobia accomplish? One, it helps to remake the relationship between the nation and the state. Defining Muslims as a threat to national security, to the nation's values and beliefs, Islamophobia thus helps to consolidate the nation in a way that is mapped out against the Muslim other. Remember, the 1990s were an intense time of delegitimizing the state, exposing the corporate agenda that was driving state policies in Canada. The international solidarity movements, the anti-globalization movement, this was an important moment of solidarity where the borders of the nation were being questioned in a very deep, profound political way. The role of the state was being really undermined and delegitimized. I would argue that Islamophobia helped to push back those critiques and to reconstitute this relationship, giving the state a particular kind of legitimacy.